guided me to this new, full rewarding life at a young age. If he has been this good to me so far, I figure I can trust him to take care of me each new day. I repeat step 3 in the morning and say thanks at night. When I was musing, I would sit around talking and fantasizing about the things that I do someday. Now I do them. I travel, meet new people, and am trusted with responsible positions. I enjoy hiking, biking, skiing, dancing, and even dating. I have friends all over the United States now, and I feel closer to some of them than I ever did to my drinking buddies. It has been over 3 years since that relapse, and I have had quite an adventure so far. I am not always happy or comfortable. I have had to reach out when I am scared or lonely. I have watched people that I like go back to their old ways. I have trouble with resentment, jealousy, and fear, among other feelings. I have found the 10th step very helpful, yet, I can't compare a few uncomfortable hours in recovery to the years of hangovers, remorse, and blackouts while using. God is so good to me. He has given me health in the NA principles and fellowship. When that old thinking comes back at, I'm not that bad, I just remember, how bad did it have to be before I want to get better? Today I live, thank you. Nowhere to turn 147. Nowhere to turn. My name is George and I am an addict and a member of Narcotics Anonymous. Today I am able to live clean and sober because of the fellowship of NA. I am now 30 years old and began using about 12 years ago. As I was grown up, I remember wanting to belong or be a part of other groups of people. I was a loner and did not know how to belong. Fear and inferiority feelings were a part of me since childhood. I was unable to participate in sports and other activities because of the fear that I could not do it. I had a fear of people, especially in groups, so I lived in a fantasy world where I was somebody. I had two close friends since childhood tried to control and isolate them. I wanted to keep them to myself for fear that others would only take them away. I was an only child and my father died when I was 3 years old. I was raised by my mother and grandparents. I was very sensitive and did not want others to see this, so I tried to hide it. I didn't like myself and always tried to be somebody other than the person I really was. At an early age, I would escape the reality of the here and now by fantasizing about the future. I thought somehow, if I could change me or find the right situation, that I could be happy someday. My need to control and dominate people only drove them away and I felt rejected. As I got older, I began to rebel at the society that I was blaming for my inability to be happy. At the same time, on a deeper level, I blamed myself. I started to get into trouble at home and at school for attention. Inside I was hurting and was very confused, but solutions were not at my disposal and I felt as though I must do whatever it took to be accepted by any crowd. I chose other kids who were getting into trouble and breaking all the rules. But even in that crowd, I felt different. Somehow I made it through high school and went on to college to please my family. I was not ready for the responsibility of college, and I wasn't motivated to learn. I felt out of place there and did poorly. At the end of my first semester, I left school and got a job. I thought that hard work and low pay was what I needed to prove my manhood. This got over quickly. 147. 148 Narcotics Anonymous. I developed problems with people wherever I went and ran from one situation to another, blaming others for the problems that arose. I began to identify with the peace and love movement that was catching on around the country. I thought the musicians of this era really had the answer, and part of that answer was to escape to enlightenment with drugs. I felt that I could be accepted by the long hairs, because they talk of unconditional love and other spiritual principles. I started smoking pot, then came the first acid trip, then speed and barbiturates. My first experience with each drug was wonderful, and I wanted to keep doing it. I especially liked the speed and acid in those days and smoked pot to keep that stoned out hold on life. I thought that the drugs went along with the spiritual and mystical philosophies. One by one, I tried all of the drugs that I said I'd never do. My relationships with women were few, and none were successful. This drove me deeper into escaping with drugs. I felt fear and excitement with this new destructive way of life. Sometimes I had doubts and second thoughts about drugs, but when I was high I felt reassured and confident. I left the world behind in those moments until I came down confused and afraid. Fear of death became an obsession with me when I wasn't high. The effects of the speed and acid helped nurture the fear. I went back to school and continued to use more and more. At one point I cut my hair and started to drink a lot. I thought a change of lifestyle was the answer, but I still managed to find reasons to take pills to study and any other excuse I could find. I felt that life was empty and meaningless. I became more and more isolated at school and my consumption of speed increased until I was using it daily, and my health began to deteriorate. I became paranoid and fearful of people, which made it harder to function. I would hang out with users on the weekends back in my hometown. It seemed that their solution to the dilemma of using was to use more until you reached the point of not caring at all. I finally quit trying to control my using and decided to quit fighting it. If I was going to be a good fiend and self-destructive, I was going to do a good job of it. It seemed that it was becoming more and more accepted that both of us were losers and we might as well stay loaded completely. Take as much dope as you can, constantly, became my new philosophy for survival. The speed runs left me burned out. I had sores in my mouth. My skin was turning yellow and much of the time I couldn't go out at night because I couldn't focus my vision and I hallucinated. Nowhere to turn. 149. I came home from school in the summer of 1971 totally wasted. It was then that I was introduced to heroin. Shooting morphine and heroin was becoming more and more a part of the local dope culture and I had a few friends who were well into it. I tried it and thought it was good for me because I could relax and eat and sleep. I learned to use a needle and by midsummer I was shooting dope 2 or 3 times a day. Jails, doing time, and violence were the new topics of conversation, no more peace and love. Now it was conning, ripping people off and doing whatever was necessary to get narcotics. I did not like any of this new talk, but the dope made it more and more acceptable. Finally, I got involved in breaking into houses and forging checks. I stole from my family, lied, sold my musical instruments for money to get drugs. At the end of the summer, I was arrested for check forgery and put in jail where I went into withdrawal. It was a nightmare to realize how far down I had fallen and was going to have to answer to the law for my actions. My mother bailed me out and the local drug council sent me to a psychologist for therapy. The therapy did not work, because I was still using. So my lawyer suggested that I go to Lexington to the federal drug hospital. I stayed long enough to detox and came home with the idea that I would go to school and everything would be okay. I also thought one shot wouldn't hurt anything. Back into active using again, I sought help again at the local drug council because I knew they were sending people to a doctor who was writing prescriptions for methadone and barbiturates for addicts. So my addiction took a new direction. I began to get my supply legally from doctors. Things were going well, so I thought, for about a year until the doctor said he could not give me any more methadone. I got panicky and bought some speed on the street, and while I was in withdrawal from methadone I started speeding. After a few days, I got crazy and started shooting a shotgun off in my backyard with imaginary bullets. I ended up in jail for 2 miserable weeks of insanity and withdrawals. The court sent me to the state hospital where they put me on 2 quaaludes a night, because all the dope fiends on the unit were requesting them for insomnia and were bringing in other drugs from business. After 30 days, I was released and I went straight to the doctor's office with another drug to add to my request. I continued to pop pills and drink codeine cough syrup and booze. 115 Narcotics Anonymous. I started dating a girl who used, and my dependence on her was a means to get more drugs. Her dependence on me was emotional. I feel that she kept me alive through those times when my using was so insane that I would have died without someone to keep me from harming myself more than I did. I had become a garbage can for drugs. Street drugs, prescription drugs, steroids, cough syrup or codeine, whatever I could get. I had been put on probation for the check forgeries and I kept getting arrested for drunk driving or for brandishing weapons. Needless to say, I was always in trouble with the probation officer and they would lock me up for a while, then send me off to another rehabilitation program or hospital. In 1974, I was sent to a long-term therapeutic community after spending about 4 months in county jail. I was very sick emotionally when I got there and stayed withdrawn for the first couple of months. I went through many intense changes in the time that I was there. Most of them were positive. I learned to function with other people and started to become responsible again. They gave me a place to belong and something to believe in. What they couldn't give me was a way to live without drugs outside the confines of the therapeutic community. I was finally graduated from their program in 1977 and as a graduate and an employee, I was allowed to drink. I decided that I wanted to return to West Virginia because the lifestyle of New York was not for me. Really, I wanted phone number of an NA member in the Atlanta, Georgia area. I spilled my guts to him over the phone and asked him what he thought. He said it sounded as though I needed to learn how to live without drugs. That was so simple, but it said it all. With God's help, I caught a bus to Atlanta. In withdrawal and praying and some crying, I made the journey. I feel that the willingness and courage to make such a move came from a power greater than myself. God, as I understand him, has worked many miracles in my life in the past 2 years of my recovery. In those first meetings, I heard people share honestly. They sat and talked with me, and they understood. They really cared because they were like me. They had been there. There was no condemnation or lectures. They gave me hope by their example. It really was possible to get a new way of life filled with happiness and usefulness to other people. I didn't have to be alone ever again. I could use my past to help others and pass this new way of life onto others who were in despair and misery. It was okay to let people know when I hurt. I didn't have to pretend to be cool and have all the answers or hide my true feelings. They loved me back to health. People were patient when I needed to talk. They listened and shared what had worked for them. I was a part of their lives. They taught me that the steps were the foundation of recovery. The program has freed me from my prison and shown me how to be myself and live life on its own terms. I owe my life to Narcotics Anonymous. God works through the people in this fellowship, and it works if you want it to. Surrender has been the key for me. 152 Narcotics Anonymous. If I work this program, my life gets better. Today I have friendship, love, and a family of brothers and sisters from all over the world, from all walks of life. We are united in a way that was once impossible for the addict. We have been delivered from a living and dying hell to happiness, peace, joy, and a fulfillment that escapes our wildest dreams in the past. It has been freely... My friends, I thought, so I thought the changes. else and then me, with no realization that I drank more than I served. My senior year of high school found me experimenting with amphetamines. My consumption of alcohol had begun to affect my grades, as were the late night hours. I believed that by taking uppers, I could improve my study habits. I continue to believe this even as my grades plummeted. Graduation prevented me from failing at school or dropping out altogether. I came to the graduation ceremony drunk, much to the chagrin and disgust of my family. I had become argumentative with everyone. I couldn't even stand myself. During the next 14 years, my life decayed tragically. I tried changing everything but myself. After I married, I joined a church that strongly suggested that its members refrain from drinking. I so wanted to be accepted. 153. 154 Narcotics Anonymous. I did not drink for a year. I was at war with myself. I felt as I had as a child, that I was different. Try as I would, want as I would, I was not, and did not be like those good people at church. They did not understand me any better than I understood them. My decision to
else.
I had an army of gay friends. I don't blame doctors or anyone else for my addiction, for my addictive personality is, and has always been, a part of me. Certain individuals in the mental health and physical health profession who should know better did contribute to my addiction and allowed it to continue. I know that recovery is my responsibility, with the help of God. I manipulated the medical profession, and not knowing what else to do, they obliged with prescriptions for symptoms, as they are so trained. I share this tragedy with too many others. Ironically, it was a psychologist that guided me into NA in another 12-step program. She had given up on me, and as a last resort, insisted that I attend